life. And also, this is repeated on YouTube. And the theme we have started is on living by strategy. Let me, before I summarize briefly what it entails and the importance of it, I think that there are several categories of people, even among Christians. People, because they are not living purposely, their lives count very little for God, family, and country. We may say that people who don't realize their potential in life. Then there are many who, at best, just make do. We call them the so-called average person. I remember when I was a student, a doctoral student in Australia, I was talking to a Yugoslavian who didn't understand much English. And for some reason, I don't remember the context. I said that, you know, I'm an average person. Then he said, Stephen, stop. And he didn't understand much English. So what he said, if he knew much English, you think that he was being abusive. He said, Stephen, that is stupid. He said that because the average person is stupid and I don't want you to consider yourself as average anymore. Of course, I still remember it more than, 40 years. And that shows how much the Lord used it to speak to me. Don't pride yourself as average person. God created you with so much potential to realize it. There's a third category of people which I call successful failures in my book, Living by Strategy. They can have a well articulated and recognized. There's a noise at the back. I hope I can go.
Please, Sister Portia, please mute yourself. Please.
Okay.
Yeah, sorry, Prof. Please, you can continue.
I call them successful failures. They can be an accomplished medical people, engineers, economists, bankers. But if you go into their private life, they are a mess. They have achieved one area because the world has a way of pushing in one dimension. For example, if you are an architect, you are building. Yeah, that's what you are known for. If you are an artist, you are fame and those who are trending and following you. If you are a business person, how much wealth? But life is not unidimensional. And oftentimes, these people, when they are at the end of their life, they say, if I had my life to live again, then they will add to it. The issue is that you will not have your life to live again. When I was appointed as a UN ambassador to Namibia, I was in training session of the newly appointed ambassadors. And one of the really successful young Canadian women, younger than me then, and I was just about 46 years old, high flyer, going to another country as representative of the Secretary General. But those who were training us asked us to fill a form and enter simply, if you had your life to live again. And this lady who was sitting next to me, I spied on her sheet, which I shouldn't have done, but she was so successful, I was thinking, you know, how would he want to do anything else? And he said that I will be a housewife. What? Hey. So this high flyer, international, Caucasian, high in the UN, he says that what he has accomplished, if he had opportunity, he would sacrifice them all. Please, don't be a successful failure. And therein lies purpose-driven living or living by strategy. If you live by strategy, most likely you will be a surprise to yourself. You accomplish far more than you yourself gave yourself credit for. Secondly, you are likely to impact people your family, your neighborhood, your workplace, and for some of you, even at the national and international levels. And therefore, as Christians, we should make sure that we are purposeful in our lives and we live by strategy. And in doing so, we don't strategize like the world. We have to anchor our life to Christ. That is the wonder of being a Christian. And when you are my age of 75, young people assume that you know everything. No. What we know is so little compared to what God has for us and what God knows. But the Christian advantage is that you plan and live strategically under God. You are like a vine. You are linked to God's omniscience, omnipotence, and omnipresence. And you can draw your inspiration, your guidance, and continuous direction. The more I grow, the more I find out that God will give you a vision to live, but he will only tell you the details, what you must do for now. And he wants you to continue to live by faith, trusting him to enlarge your circles and your vision as you go along. And that is why Habakkuk said that the just shall live by his faith, which Paul quotes in Romans 1:17 also. Having given a longer preamble, I'm sure somebody will say, when is he going to talk about strategic living? Let me share with you slightly modified content of my book, Living by Strategy. 10 points of living by strategy and how you can actualize it, not something in the air, but on a day-to-day basis. First of all, if you are a Christian linked to God, trusting in him, and therefore drawing on his vine life, what you have to do, the first thing of the 10 points in living by strategy is this. You have to be intentional about your life. Sounds simple. Intentional about your life, yes. You won't believe it that probably 95, if not more, percent of all people are not intentional about how they live. Of course, all of us are products of our culture, our schooling, our upbringing, what our workers demand of us, our national milieu, whether you are in economic crisis, as some of us are experiencing with the haircut, they call it in our country. You are driven by so many forces. And unless you are in the leadership literature, as we call it, high self-monitor, able to somehow stand outside and occasionally look intentionally how you are living, you are not likely to live by strategy. So the first thing, as simple as it is to be intentional about living. I'll give you one example. I was in a high-paying job for most of my actually life. And at the age of 46, as a Christian, I was spending much of my time and my money in helping others, which you may say is quite good. But if you are not saying a little and taking care of your family, one crisis, and then you are in trouble. Somebody dropped a booklet, because I could read the whole thing in 30 minutes. And therefore, it's called Common Sense by Art Williams. Maybe it took longer than 30 minutes, but a short, relatively short time. And all basically was saying that be intentional about how you manage your finances, and shared one or two points, and boom, it transformed my life. And since then, by God's grace, not only have I enjoyed the blessing of personal financial management, but I've written about 5 books, and many people around the world will know about my book, 12 keys to financial success, which has been a blessing to possibly millions. The first is be intentional. The second is you need an anchor, or what Stephen Covey calls it, true north, or in my book, I call it organizing principle. Life is such that each one of us, consciously or unconsciously, make hundreds of decisions every day. Now, if you add to it living by strategy, you may be a candidate for the asylum, the mental hospital. But I tell you, like God wanted life to be very, very simple, despite the fact that he wants us to live strategically. For example, the Global Positioning System, GPS, which now allows us to so much fab direction, even to my village. Do you know that it was God who, when he created the world, he put the magnetic north, so that if you have a compass, wherever you are, in the olden time, you carried your compass. Now you may have a Google and other things. But the principle all depends that God gave us a fixed reference point. And if you don't have that one, living by strategy will be so overwhelming rather than being simple for you. And so the second is you need either, depending upon the terminology, you like a true horizon, a firm reference point. Christian, that is Christ and the word of God impliedly. For example, people sometimes, Stephen, you are doing so much. And I said, no, my life is very simple. I only have to ask and believe in that, what would Jesus have me do under this circumstance? And as much as the situations may vary, when I want to obey, it becomes relatively simple. How do I relate to my wife? What would Jesus have me do? She has given me a sister, a friend, and a bride. And therefore, marriage becomes simple to me. As someone says, that if a man says he's filled with the Holy Spirit, ask his wife, what will I have to do with the resources God give me, money? What will Jesus have me do about my work? He says that whatever you do, do it with the Lord in view, to glorify us, doing it for the Lord. Your life becomes simple and effective if you have a very clear rule, that overarching rule in your life. The only trouble is this: you may have the wrong one. For example, some people make looking for money. You can become Bill Gates, Warren Buffett, or the rest. But at the end, where will it take you? Artists, when you have gotten your fame, politician with your power, make sure that you have, in living by strategy, you have this reference, overarching reference. And let it be, I recommend to you Jesus Christ. It makes my life, to others, very complicated, but a ball and very simple. Number three, clarify your vision, your missions, excuse me. I'm going to the too fast to the fourth. In other words, what are you here for? Am I here on earth to be an economist? To be a UN expert? To be a vice chancellor or rector? Which by God's grace I have been, or to be a diplomat? Even my best love work, being the husband of the best woman God made. No. This goal will help me fulfill my mission. But you must be clear with the purpose for which you exist. God says he created us for his own glory. Isaiah 43, verse 7, and is repeated again in verse 21 of Isaiah 43. You are a royal priesthood, a chosen people, God's own, that you may declare the glory of God. If you know the ultimate purpose for your life, it becomes easier to live strategically. Why? Because your strategy must go to feed into your mission and your purpose. Assuming that God wants you to be rich enough to help other people in the cause of the question is, being rich cannot be what a Christian is living for. Or being the topmost academic. I can't qualify myself as the topmost, but if you are a professor emeritus, you know a little bit of those who are the academic top there. I can tell you, in my language, you say that there's nothing attractive in the belly of the lizard. Let me tell you, have a clear mission and purpose for living. That's why I like the hymn. A charge to keep I have, God to glorify, never dying soul to and fit for the sky, to serve the present age is my calling to fulfill. That is number three. And once you are clear with your mission, you must translate it into epochal vision. Did you hear the word epochal vision? Because your vision for your whole life will be equivalent to your mission when you accomplish them all. But every stage of your life, I adopted a 10-year framework, which seems to suit every 10 years, you change from one level to another. En français, on dit plus ou moins, plus or minus. You see, so I have a 10-year plan. Now I am in the sixth year of my 10-year plan for my 70s, and I'm already dreaming about my 10-year plan for my 90s. If you think that I'm too old, well, you wait, I may come to your funeral. Remember Moses. On a more serious note, Christian should not make vision like the world does. And of course, I'm not talking, I can't have time to talk about the power of vision. Each one of these is a talk of its own. So I've just given you the hors d'oeuvre or the taste of them. The world always look for the vision of what they want to accomplish. I call it the vision of accomplishment. I want to make this money, build this, take my children to school here. They are good, especially if you want to be effective. But there's another aspect of the Christian's vision. I call it the vision of being, what you become. The Bible, for example, says, what shall it profit a man to gain the whole world and lose his own soul? So we must have a vision of what we want to accomplish, but how and we do it is very important, because in the end, we must be more righteous, more nearer to God, and more of a blessing to others. Because you can achieve your millions of dollars or pounds or whatever, ringgit, but you can do it as a thief. You would have gotten the money, but you have lost your soul. So your vision should be double track. Vision of accomplishment, but vision of being. And that leads me to the sixth one, that is values. Values, the fifth one, values. Because your values determine how you go about achieving both your mission and your vision, especially your vision of accomplishment. And it's so important I'm not talking about, 25 values. You will not even remember them, let alone live by them. But I would encourage you to come up with maximum of 5. Integrity, under which you have honesty, accountability, and transparency, is very important to the Christian. The love for God and neighbor, service to humanity, and making sure you are growing every day spiritually. These are suggestions, but your values determine how you accomplish your vision and your mission. I wish I had time to spend more time on this. So let me recap. Be intentional about how you live. Have a stable reference point, which I recommend: Jesus and his word.
I'm sure Prof's internet maybe got disrupted, so let's hold on for some few minutes. I'm sure he will get back.
Are we back online?
Yes, please, Prof. We can hear you.
Sorry, there was a break in the transmission. Good. Where did I lose? Did I finish with values?
Yeah, you were recapping what the various... Yeah.
Very good. Okay. So just to... First, to living by strategy requires being intentional about how you live, ensuring that your life is guided by a reliable anchor or true north or organizing principle. 3, you must clarify your mission, your purpose on earth. Then you must have a vision of being and a vision of accomplishment for specific epochs, normally about 10 years at a time. That's what I find is useful. You may go for 15 or 20 if you are, but I find 10-year slices allow me to have clarity in what I want to achieve there. And then you must be sure that you are clear about your values, because how you achieve these are important. The 6th is when the rubber is almost touching the street, is translating your vision of accomplishment and vision of being into SMART goals. SMART goals. In fact, I've just taken in my book on living by strategy, I advise, by no means impose it, on 8 areas of your life where you must set specific goals for the period in which you are having the vision. And I'm not going to go to how to do all those things because I'm giving an overview. The physical area. Many Christians don't have goals to make sure that they are in good health and forget that their bodies are the temple of God, the Holy Spirit. 1 Corinthians 6:20. Again, you set a simple goal about your eating habit, your exercise, your sleeping, the discipline. For example, I have found one of the greatest gifts the Lord has given me is when I was younger, discipline myself to go to bed. And for almost, I don't know how many decades, 50 or 60 years, I go to bed at 8:30 against all odds and wake up at 4 a.m. That gives me 7.5 hours, but good rest. But it gives me also about 3 hours to start life, thinking, praying, reading my Bible, and strategizing before the rat race day begins. Then goals for financial life, goals for my professional life, goals for social life, goals for intellectual life, goals for love life. Don't take my marriage for granted. I have goals for daily, weekly, annual relationship with my wife. Then my family life, raising my children. In other words, set SMART goals for within achievable. SMART mean, of course, simple, measurable, attainable, realistic, time-bound goals. Once again, since we are with the overview, I will continue without going into the details because if I want to do that for the 10, we will not finish. That brings me to the servant. And the servant one is this. We are not talking about pie in the air, but discipline. The discipline to implement your goals. Of course, while talking about goals, I mentioned those 8 quickly. There's a need for balancing your personal, relational, professional life. If you don't, you will be a successful failure. But then you need the discipline. For example, let me give you a simple example that has made a difference in my life. When I was 23 years or thereabout, I heard 2 statements. And it was 4 years, in fact, 3 years before I got a fiancé and 4 years before I got married. So I was not on the war path. I wasn't looking for even a wife. But the Holy Spirit told me these are the things you need the day you marry. The first was that if spiritual comment on me than anybody else on earth, because he knows me better than those whom I meet in church. Second one was from Norman Vincent Peale, and he says that if a man, he hasn't seen a man who read his Bible day and night with his wife, who had a problem they couldn't solve. And for 49 years, my wife and I have done the same. And boy, we are preparing for our 50th honeymoon, hopefully in Dubai. Don't ask me why Dubai. But since I've mentioned Dubai, in order not to think of me as the politicians who are having flights in Dubai, my son-in-law is an Emirate pilot. So he lives in Dubai with my daughter, who is a surgeon, a pediatrician. So I may go there for free, sleep for free, eat for free, and come back for free. So don't be jealous. Most of you wouldn't have grown up children yet. Train up your children the way they should go, and then they will take you to Dubai. So you must discipline yourself. NBNB, no Bible, no breakfast. Since I became a Christian at the age of 18 or thereabout, I have stuck disciplining myself. No breakfast, no Bible, no breakfast, or else you will not achieve all your plans. So that is the servant. You know, I've changed the order, so always I have to go and look at the same thing, but I hope I will not leave anything out. Now, let me go to the eight. The eight is very interesting to me because, and I must be careful about it, because as a professor, as soon as you mention knowledge, people think that, you know, you are talking about going to get a degree. No. But in order to live strategically, once you have identified your goals, areas, and your vision, you must make sure that you have gotten the modicum of skills and knowledge you need to effect it. For example, finance, most people need a good book, which they can buy and read it, a Christian book on finances, and read it for 2 hours, and their life is changed. My wife and I had to write a book on God's master plan for Christian marriage. You don't need an encyclopedia, but you need to be committed to certain basic principles. So the knowledge and the skills I'm talking about is not encyclopedic knowledge. But let me tell you, without knowledge, you will not be able to live by strategy, whether about your marriage, about raising your children, or about your work. Last but one, I've mentioned discipline, which of course goes with tenacity and grit. Then the ninth one is having, and now listen to me carefully, having a mission, vision, goal, and roles-driven time management. I read a lot of books about time management, you know, and then the tools. No, your time must be disciplined to achieve your mission, your vision, your roles. In my case, as a father, as a husband, as a Christian leader, and the rest, and as a CEO. I'm still the CEO of one of the biggest institutions in Ghana, which my wife and I founded 24 years ago. That's Ghana Christian International High School. The disciplining of my time is to enable me to accomplish what God has led me to plan and live for. It is not a matter of, you know, just, oh, I'm busy. No, because if you do that, you see that you have more time to enjoy yourself than even those who are paranoid about that. Your time management should be driven by your strategy. For example, when my children were young, and up to now, I don't join any club. My life centered around three things: my work, my church and Christian activities, and my home. That meant there were many things I would let go. Why? Because a charge to keep I have. God glorify, and never dying souls to save and fitted for the sky, my calling to fulfill. The last one is that make it fun. Ooh. Living by strategy, it's not like going to, you know, the Third World War. No. It's a fun because once you are in sync with God, you are doing what you believe is your purpose here. You are clear with your vision. You have set them to goals. You have been able to say, as a result, no to many other things in order to do few things better. But have a goal. Have it. Bring in your family. You and your spouse must be involved. Your children. I just spent a wonderful Sunday morning with my nephew and wife who have come to visit us from North Carolina with their three children, having a good time. Charlie, we enjoyed ourselves. Why? Because it's part and parcel of my living by strategy that my children, my nephews, the grandchildren should be brought together as a Christian family. It's not an add-on. Every other Saturday, my four children, their spouses, and their children, we have a WhatsApp video conference, and we have a good time from the three-year-old trying to have a way through to those who are planning to be prefects in their school, to managers, and the rest. If you live by strategies, it should not be something you get paranoid about, but must be fun because you are fulfilling your purpose. Oh, when you live by strategy, you won't say at the end that if I had my life to do, live, I will live it differently because you have accomplished far more often than what you thought you could imagine because you have accomplished it with God on your side. I thank you very much. And if there's any time for questions, if the good thing about being old, that you can refuse to answer the question when it's too difficult for you. Thank you.
Thank you, Prof. Thank you so much. These are indeed great truth and insights you have given us tonight. So, brethren, please, the floor is open for questions. So if any one of us have questions, please, the floor is open. And as Prof said, he can choose to answer or not to answer, but I believe he will answer. Yeah, so. Okay, please, Sandra, please. You have the floor, please. You can go ahead with your question, please.
Thank you very much. God bless you for your graciousness, sharing your life with us and encouraging us to do. Please, my question is about how to marry your vision. How to marry your vision? I mean, okay, so like you have the vision, you know the purpose, but then you are limited with resources or the medium for getting there. In the meanwhile, as you gather the resource or how do you call it? Try to do the thing that you believe God has prepared you for. What do you do? How do you get your vision? Because maybe the thing will involve some huge amount of money. It means you have to go and look for money. Or we shouldn't always say that we want to get the money first. We should just start and trust God to help us. Like, how do you go about it? Or I know the obvious, I mean, for the obvious answer for a Christian will be to pray about it. But in situations where, I think I should just go. So, for instance, I know that I'm supposed to be a teacher. I know that God has blessed me with the gift of teaching. They say that thing that you don't even prepare for, but you go and you are able to teach. Like, I'm able to control classroom management. It's just a gift. I don't know how it happens. My colleagues come to ask me, how do you do it? And I don't know how. But then I've worked in a lot of private schools. to the extent that for one private school, when I was even pregnant, I was sort of, they said I was on contract, so I was just taken out because they were going to give me my 3 months maternity leave, and they were not ready to do that. So they just took me off the schedule and said, oh, we are not renewing your contract. You haven't done anything, but we are not renewing your contract.
Understand what you are arguing. Yeah.
So now I'm like, I'm tired. You go to another school, you have given birth, you can't, 3 months. I said, I can bring my baby to school. My baby will sit at the baby's class with a caretaker, will still work. They said, no. Like,
no, yeah.
So I also have to build my family. I also have to take care of my children. I also need money. Now I have an MPhil in education, and I'm like, oh, me, I know that I'm supposed to be a children's teacher. So even if I have a PhD, I'll still come and teach children with my PhD. Can you pay me something little to just honor my qualification?
What is your first degree, by the way? This is not, if I may ask.
Okay, so my first degree was in social work. Then I didn't really know what I was about.
Okay, fine. Uh-huh. Anyway, first of all, contact the one who organized this one. Get my contact, and then we'll talk about your specific career issues rather than on this platform, okay? I'm an educationist. I've taught from primary one to become a professor emeritus, and now I'm ahead of probably the biggest boarding private school in the country.
Yeah.
Maybe the second, there's one in the St. Andrews, but we stand in a class of our own. So we can talk about that one later. But let me answer your initial question, which is generic and therefore for the whole group. I believe that if you live by strategy, one of the things you strategize is breaking the bottleneck. It's like when you are doing strategic management, SWOT analysis. So let me give an example. With all your passion, and you may be better off starting a school, a Montessori primary school or something of your own. What you need is strategic partners, people who are prepared to give you their house, which nobody is living in there, for you to start there, and they become shareholders, maybe on a 50-50. There are so many options, so never. But what I would like to say is that strategic living is not just dreaming as if, you know, there are no restrictions. Let me give you, for example, when I started these ideas, which are led to my book about strategic living, I felt that I would like to be a millionaire. Wow. At that time, actually, if I did my balances, you know, living in America and the rest, you know, you use the plastic and that things, I was rather in the negative rather than going to be a millionaire. But when I did my research and found how simple it is for the average person to become a millionaire by investing only 10% of their resources, income, I doubled it to 20 because I was 46 years and I thought it was too late. I have to. It required time. And then planning within the framework, voila, then it becomes so simple. And when you make, of course, CD millionaire is not the American millionaire, but when you make your first million, your second million comes almost in a year or two, if you know how to manage your resources, and off it goes. So sometimes it requires a much more time, again, knowledge. In your case, definitely. I don't think that you are going to be a teacher in the ordinary private schools, which will not pay you even for maternity. That's not the place you should be looking at. Again, without knowledge, the people will perish. And I hope so. If you start living strategically, you also will find solutions with the knowledge which I taught about and skills. And almost the impossible becomes possible. Okay. Any other question?
Thank you, Prof. God
bless you. Thank you so much. Yeah, Azira, please, you have the floor.
Thank you for the opportunity, and thank you, Prof, for all that you've taught us. I've learned so much so far. My question is, in a case where you have had a plan before, but then life happened and everything got crushed or something of that sort, how do you bridge between the fear of, I know also the fear of plans not working? The fear of plans not working again, and being able to plan in that, especially when you had, how you talk about a time frame, 10 years, like what if you had a 5-year plan and it didn't work? How do you bridge that fear or pick up yourself to be able to plan again? Because then, I don't know, sometimes this scripture comes to mind that man proposes, but God disposes. How are we able to work through that?
That is not in scripture. It's a wise saying, but not it. That is not true. Okay, but I've heard it. Any other questions? I've seen the failure and the fear of it, and what do you do with it? Yes, what does the next person? Let me take about a few so that we can run off on time.
Okay. Yeah. So, Prof, somebody has, Mike has put in the chat, how can one get your book? Yeah.
Okay.
And Prof, I think I will add that the third question. In when you intend to live by strategy, with all the great points you shared, is there a need to have an accountability partner, especially on the part that you shared on the discipline? Yeah, is there the need for accountability partner, or you need to thrive through yourself, or you think,
please. Let me have two more then.
Yeah, please. Any other questions so that we can wrap up? Yeah.
Okay. Hello, I have a question.
Okay, so Anita, please, you have the floor.
All right. So, sorry, I joined in no long ago, but there are a few questions that came in. Okay. I would want to know about the issue of accountability, and then with the issue of mentorship. Okay. If we are talking about strategy, with the issue of accountability, should it necessarily be somebody in your field? Let's say I'm in the field of education. Do I necessarily have to find somebody who is in that same field to be accountable to, and also to mentor me in that field? Now, if I find myself in a place where you don't really, really get that mentorship, what else do you do aside research? Yeah.
Good. Last, but not the least.
Brethren, please, any other questions?
Okay. Don't let us manufacture.
Okay.
Anymore.
Okay. Yeah, Prof, please, I don't see any hand raised for now. So okay.
You know, Mr. Edison, the one who invented the bulb, electric bulb, says that there's never a failure. Every failure means you have learned one more way not to do things. And so, first of all, if you do live by strategy and plan, the likelihood of failure goes down. However, the world we live in, none of us has control over everything. For example, in Ghana, none of us, even those of us older, expected the impact of the haircut, the financial economic crisis. So, therefore, many actually, especially, let me say, of the Pentecostal and the charismatic traditions think that life is plus, 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 and not a negative. No, It is not true. So that's the first thing. And as a man or a woman thinketh in his heart, so is he. If you are thinking is that, you know, if you don't make it, then voila, that is the end. I always tell people, in fact, I was about to share it today, but I decided not to, because I've said it so many times. I was speaking to our students. They were having their commendation service. You know, I'm professor emeritus, but I failed my O-level and I went to Second World War. For Ghanaians, you understand what the Second World War is. And I think even in the Second World War, when it came to English, I might have passed with a half a mark because I got my O-level
year.
So, first of all, don't be discouraged when you fail, because often failure teaches you more than instant success. The Bible says that the righteous man will fall 7 times and rises again. When you do fail, ask why. Go to somebody to advise, and oftentimes your next attempt will make you better. Sometimes also people start too big instead of starting small and growing, and therefore the impact becomes great. How can one get your book? If you are in Ghana, you can always get, of course, those outside can get it on Google, but those in Ghana, well, you can get it from Challenge Bookshop in Kokomlimri or the publisher Smartline. You can go, Google them, but you can also get it from me. And you can always reach me on the WhatsApp number 027-1957-871. And there's a wonderful network of transport that sends it all around the country. And we would deliver it almost to your next door where you live. It's 100 Ghana cedis per book. If you don't go and buy it yourself and have to send it to you in Obuasi or Tamale, you may have to pay about 5 more cedis more. But we will take it to the transport yard for free for you. Now, do you need accountability or group? The answer is yes and no. You don't need necessarily some high-level professional, but especially if you are married, your spouse, or your children, because we are talking about personal strategic plan. It is not how to, you know, become the topmost person in your workplace. We'll come back to that. That is the second person talking about mentorship and the rest. My personal strategic plan, the only person I share with is my wife. He's talking about how I want to work with the Lord closely. My financial plan I want to achieve and how I want to do so that, and we discuss it about 3 times a year. Again, we talk about our relationship. Is of course, I'm talking about my marriage. She's the best person about the children. Even when they are older now, we plan as to how do we support them as having as adult children. One of the things is meeting every other week on WhatsApp and praying and then sharing our lives and where they need this, throwing a word here and there. So in my case, the person that I share this with is my wife. In fact, has been for most of my life. And it's not a great big deal of expertise that you want to, if you get the book, you find out that we are talking about simply better organizing your life to achieve much under the power of the Holy Spirit. But when it comes to one or two technical areas, for example, on financial management, you may need to consult a financial expert or any of my books, which is meant for ordinary 12 Keys to Financial Success, Christians and Wealth Creation, 101 Ways to Find the Money to Save and Invest, Investment Opportunities for Almost Everyone in Ghana, and how to take the tire out of retirement. These are five books of mine on finances. So we are not talking about quantum physics. So, and you are, it's only when you have a specialized profession, of course, you may need someone to guide you in those areas. But here, much of what you have to do in personal living by strategy doesn't. But always good to have an accountable partner. But always don't go for, we are not talking about the specialist. We are talking about a trusted friend, a spouse, and that whom you pray together, share your ideas, and go along with it. So I think that should be enough for the day. And the more I have to tell you about living by strategy, the more I get excited about living by strategy myself. God bless you.
God bless you so much, Prof. It's been really a great session and a very informative one. Thank you. We are so grateful for sharing your life, sharing this insight with us. And I believe that the Lord will grant us the grace to do. Please, Prof, we will request of you to pray for us. Yeah, you can pray with us.
Father in heaven, we thank you that you created us, that we may have life and have it more abundantly. What you have been talking about is how to translate this into reality in our individual lives. I pray for my sisters and all those who are online, that Lord, you will help them to clarify their minds, get the partnerships and the type of books they need, and be able to draw a simple strategy and live by them so that their impact on your kingdom, on their families, their personal life, and their workplace and nation will be enlarged, that in the end, your great name will be glorified through Jesus Christ, our God and our Savior. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Father, in the same vein, we also pray and thank you so much for the life of Prof. Adei. Indeed, you have used him, O Lord, to be a blessing to many and many generations, and we are not an exception. We thank you for the exceptional grace upon his life and his family, O Lord. We continue to ask you, O Lord, that continue to strengthen him, O Lord. Even as tonight he has shared his life insight that you have given to him, Lord, we pray that you continue to give him more insight, O Lord. Even as he increases in years, so shall his strength be in the name of Jesus. I pray that through him you will raise another of his kind, because your word is that we should be fruitful and multiply. Lord, as he has poured out on us, we pray that raise us, Lord, as a fruit from him in the name of Jesus. We ask of you your blessing upon him and the family, Lord. We thank you for an answered prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Prof, thank you so much. God bless you for joining us this evening. And brethren, we want to thank you all for joining us. Yeah, I have some wonderful friends here who joined us. I hope they are still on the call. That's my colleague's student here in University of Haifa in Israel. So some were able to join us this evening. Mike was online. I don't know if he has dropped off. Kalkidan is from Ethiopia. I don't know if she's still here. Then Elad is also an Israeli here. And thank you so much for joining the session. I hope you were blessed. And sister, God bless you all for joining tonight. It's such a blessing to join this evening. And I thank God that we have learned a lot this evening to go and really, really impact our lives. So may we share the grace. Can we share the grace together? The grace
of our Lord
Jesus Christ, the love of
God, the love of God,
and the
Spirit.
Please, in 2 minutes, please, Nana, can you give us the announcement, please? The announcement shortly.
Okay. Bye-bye. Bye.
Thank you so much. God bless you. God bless you. Nana, please, you can share the announcement with us, please.
Yes, please. So, God willing, on Friday, this Friday, being our first Friday of a new month, we have a prayer chain from 10 a.m. to 6 p.m. Friday, 10 a.m. to 6 p.m. So please, let's do well to connect and pray. And also, every day, we have our Islamic prayers every day, and we meet on WhatsApp, 6 p.m., Monday to Friday, 6 p.m. So please, if you have the time, kindly do well to join and let's pray for our Islamic friends. God richly bless you all. Sister Vera, God bless you for moderating this session. God richly bless you.
Thank you for giving us the announcement. Yeah. So please, we have the evening session, right? The Islamic prayers tonight. So those who will want to stay and pray, please, you are welcome to join and pray. Yeah. But God bless you for joining and hope to see you, God willing, next week. Bye.
Bye.
Yeah, Ezra, please, do you know who is leading this evening? Mm-hmm.